If you want to compute the inverse Fourier transform of a function, you often need to compute a complex integral. Fortunately, we can often use the theorem of residues to compute these integrals. In this video, you will see an explicit example. We have our u hat of omega equals 1 over 1 plus omega squared, and we want to compute the inverse Fourier transform of this function u hat of omega. So that means that we want to find our u of x equals inverse Fourier transform, so 1 over 2 pi, e to the power I omega x times u hat, so divided by 1 plus omega squared, and we want to integrate with respect to omega. So, you already see that this will become nice if we try to use the theorem of residues for that. We have to be a bit careful, this requires between three cases. Our parameter x is real, it can be positive, negative or zero, and we have to treat those three separately. We'll see why later on when we will do the calculation. Let's start with x positive. So, what can we do? Use a complex function f of z e to the power izx over 1 plus z squared. Remember, we want to integrate with respect to omega later on, so we replace the omegas by z's, like that. I use the contour over here. I see if we will parameterize here our LR later on with z equals omega, we get the desired integral this one back. Well, up to a factor 2 pi, but we'll fix the factor 2 pi later on. So there we have our function f of z, we have our contour. So we can use the theorem of residues. Integral f dz along c equals 2 pi I times the residue of f of z and z equals I. Because the only singularity of the function over here, singularities are at plus I and minus I, and only the one at plus I is inside the contour. So there we have our theorem of residues. Because f of z is analytic on and inside c, except at those simple poles. Because remember, our x is a parameter. Our x is not the real part of z. If in this case x would be the real part of z, we would be in big trouble because our function would not be analytic. But x is just a positive parameter. So we have e to the power I number, some number times z divided by 1 plus z squared, which is perfectly analytic except at z equals I. Now, computing the residue is easy. You can factorize the denominator and you can compute the residue. So cancel out the one factor of z minus I and plug in z equals I because we have a simple pole. Yields the residue e to the power minus ix over 2i. So the total integral equals 2 pi I times this residue. So we're left with the factor pi, factors 2i cancel out, times e to the power minus x. So there we are, end of step 2. Use of theorem of residues and computation of the residue. Then the integral along LR over there becomes nice. You just parameterize z equals omega and you get the integral from minus R to R e to the power I omega x divided by 1 plus omega squared. Well, that's of course what we want to have because we want to send R to infinity, and then as you see already, you will get this integral over here, the one we want. Step 3. Now in step 4, we want to get rid of the integral over here along CR. And this is the place where we need x to be positive because we want to use Jordan's lemma. Jordan's lemma says if you have some integral along CR, g of z e to the power I az dz, this integral equals 0 in the limit, provided a is positive and we have some other conditions. So we need a positive here. And as you see, the role of our a is played by the x over here. So we can only use Jordan if x is positive. If x would be negative, by the way, and then this integral along CR wouldn't vanish at all because the function would blow up exponentially. So here we need our x to be positive. So what more do we need for Jordan? Gz has to be analytic in the upper half plane. If you are far enough, well, that's fine. We have a singularity here at I, but if you take your R0 further than that, like that, then outside of that, your function is nice and analytic. C has to be semicircle. Okay, that's fine. And then last condition, g of z in norm has to be bounded by some mr, which goes to zero if you set r to infinity. So we have to find some bound on our g of r, on our g of z. Well, in this case, our g of z will be 1 over 1 plus z squared, and we have to bound it by some mr on cr, such that our mr will go to zero. So, reverse triangle inequality to estimate our g of z, norm of 1 plus z squared, bigger equal than absolute value of the first part minus second part in norm. So the absolute value of 1 equals 1. And the norm of z squared equals r squared, because we are on cr. And the absolute value of 1 minus r squared equals r squared minus 1, because we will take a big r. So we can estimate the norm of our g of z, smaller equal than 1 over r squared minus 1, which we set as r mr. And of course, you see if you set send r to infinity, that your mr will be 0. So we can apply Jordan's lemma to show that the integral along cr goes to 0 if you send r to infinity. And that's just the end of step 4. Now we can wrap up everything. So the integral along LR equals our residue minus the integral along CR. Then we take R to infinity on the left and the right hand side. Sorry, it's written down what the integral along LR is. So if you take R to infinity, the limit on the right hand side exists because this part does not depend on R. And this one goes to zero. So this one vanishes, and on the right hand side we get P times e to the power minus ix. And on the left-hand side, we get the principal value of this integral over here. Now, the integral converges, so the principal value is the same as the integral itself. So so you can leave out the PV part here. And now you know that we get our u of x if we divide left and right by 1 over 2 pi. So u of x equals 1 over 2 pi times this integral. And divide on the right-hand side by 1 over 2 pi, we get 1 half times e to the power minus ix. For x positive. Now, x negative goes exactly in the same way. Try it yourself. Only difference is that you get e to the power plus x over there. How do you do it? You choose the CR in the lower half plane instead of the upper half plane. So you have again one singularity at minus I instead of plus I. And now you can use your Jordan in the lower half plane. So that's for x negative. So you see it's almost the same. Result is also almost the same apart from the sign over there. Then for x equals 0, you don't have to do any complex integration at all. You get this integral over here, and you can use real integration. You can integrate it directly. You get the arctangent of omega between the boundaries. Arctangent of infinity equals pi over 2 minus lower boundary. Arctangent of minus infinity minus pi over 2. So you get pi over 2 minus minus pi over 2 equals pi divided by 2 pi equals 1 half. And there you also have it for x equals 0. Now we started with a Fourier transform. We computed the original function. And there's a relatively easy check sometimes whether you did this correctly, because you went from inverse to original function. Now you can go back to check whether you did this correctly by taking the Fourier transform of the function you got. So we check whether the u hat of omega is indeed equal to the Fourier transform of u of x, which we can compute. Because we know u of x for x negative, we have e to the power x, and for x positive, we have e to the power minus x. So let's try to compute this integral, and we see that it's in fact doable. We can turn this one and that one both into one exponential over here and over there. We can integrate with respect to x. We get the 1 over 1 minus I omega times the same exponential between the boundaries. And here we get minus 1 minus I omega exponential between the boundaries. In the limits minus infinity and plus infinity, they will vanish, so you only have the terms at 0, which gives you a 1 over 1 minus I omega. And here we have in the lower boundary a 0, so we get a minus sign and 1 over minus 1 minus I omega. Well, doesn't look like the 1 over 1 plus omega squared. Well, we'll get there if you multiply the first term by 1 minus 1 minus I omega and the other one by 1 minus I omega. In the numerators, in the denominators, you get minus 1 minus I omega squared. And you have a minus I omega minus minus I omega. Those will cancel out. So you get a minus 2 over minus 1 minus omega squared equals 2 over 1 plus omega squared. Factor 1 half cancels. And indeed, you get a 1 over 1 plus omega squared. So everything looks fine. Because we got our original function, and we checked that indeed, if we take the Fourier transform of this original function, we get the u hat of omega back where we started with.